The passing scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.
Hello, and welcome to the 37th installment of the monthly BCTV program titled The Passing Scene News and Views. I'm your announcer, Gloria Jean Meiser, co-compiler of the Passing Scene series, a 24-volume collection of illustrated Berks County history books. Also appearing are Tadd Kelby Casner, president of Center Park Historic District, Georgia Meiser IX, county historian, and Dr. Thomas B. Souders and Dr. John R. Pankratz, who will join the panel on behalf of the Friends of Chamber Music this year, observing its 65th anniversary. Welcome to all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gloria.
We open today's program with a series of views taken on Saturday, November the 4th at Fleetwood, principally along Richmond Street, a stone's throw from the former plant of the Fleetwood Metal Body Company and F.M. Brown's Fleetwood Feed and Grist Mill.
All right, everybody had the first illustration, please. Okay. The gathering along Richmond Street in Fleetwood on Saturday, November the 9th, was to observe the dedication of a Pennsylvania historical marker honoring the history of the Fleetwood Metal Body Works, pictured there on the screen. Up front, it should be noted that the Fleetwood Metal bodies were all fashioned using heavy-gauge aluminum so that particulars of design could be accomplished by hammering out the metal stretched across a wooden substructure. Fleetwood auto bodies were all custom fashioned, as opposed to production line steel auto parts pressed out by the thousands. As a general statement, it could be said that no two Fleetwood auto bodies were alike. It was all custom work, which is why it could take 6 months or longer to produce a single Fleetwood body. Next. On the screen, we have an example of some of the things that that the Fleetwood Metal Body Works made. Detachable top limousine. The chassis I don't recognize, apparently is European. Notice the bodywork that's apparent there, how unusual that it is a detachable top, by the way. I could never understand why in the wintertime you would have a detachable top, no sides, and the chauffeur sitting out in the rain or the snow. It must have held their employees in low regard. There we have it says the metal Reading Metal Body Company, Fleetwood, PA. They started in Reading, but very early on moved to Fleetwood. The next view is that's an SVG.
SGV.
SGV, sorry about that. Sternberg, Graham and Van Tyne, body that was brought from Boyertown for display at the dedication. I looked very carefully at the fenders. While it was an old aluminum body, that was very, very thick aluminum. Very impressive, as you can see there. Continuing on, let me see. Up front, a wealthy client, by the way, it could take, as I said, up to 6 months or even longer for a particular body. Up front, how did you get one of these automobiles with the custom body? A wealthy client would meet with a company representative to discuss particulars as to what form the body should take. Would it be a two or a four-door, open or closed body? What color or colors would be desired? What fabric should be used for the upholstery? One customer chose genuine leopard skin. You wouldn't do that today. Next, the customer would order the chassis. Many Fleetwood Metal Body Works customers chose either a Packard or a Cadillac chassis, although the company would provide a body to fit any particular chassis. As custom bodies tended to be a good deal heavier than those found on lesser automobiles, a chassis with a powerful engine and a substantial frame would be needed. While the Fleetwood Cadillac immediately comes to mind, and this I found surprising, the greatest number of Fleetwood bodies were attached to Packard chassis. Next view. The Fleetwood Metal Body Works existed from 1909 to 1930. In 1925, the company was purchased by General Motors' subsidiary, Fisher Body Company, which 5 years later moved operations to Detroit. This was a devastating blow to locals, and they said for years no one in Fleetwood would buy a General Motors product. I think they sort of held that against them. Looking at the picture, on the left, the gentleman with the light-colored coat was is William A. Strauss, president of the Fleetwood Historical Society, who, by the way, is an excellent artist. I don't think he takes enough credit for the work that he does. Their museum has work that he has done, some murals and smaller works, all very, very impressive with great detail, a really fine work. The gentleman on the right-hand side is Paul D. Zimmerman, who represented the Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission. He came for the removal of the cloth over the marker. Next one. Standing on the left with the microphone in her hand is Tammy Gore, G-O-R-E, who is the mayor presently of Fleetwood. And there right behind Mr. Smith, you can see the monument, which has just been uncovered at the time that she starts to talk. The next. Now, in the background, you see a building that was part of the Fleetwood Auto Body Works. And that sign was repainted maybe, 10, 15 years ago. And luckily, the paint has held up reasonably well. But that was one of the buildings that existed. The greater number of buildings would have been on the right-hand side as you're looking at this picture. Unfortunately, a number of years ago, there was a devastating fire that destroyed all the buildings that were on that left-hand side, on the lot that you see where this car is now situated. It boggles the mind to realize that some of the finest auto bodies in the world were made by craftsmen in the small town of Fleetwood. Without exception, Fleetwood bodies were magnificent. Next. There are proclamations that were given, one by Judy Schwenk on behalf of, as a senator of Pennsylvania, and the other one is Tammy Gore, the mayor of Fleetwood. Next. There is the sign that was uncovered and dedicated. I believe I have a close-up. Next one. Fleetwood Metal Body Company, established in 1909 by Harry C. Ulrich. The firm designed and fabricated custom auto bodies for the finest domestic and foreign automobile manufacturers, notably Cadillac, Duesenberg, Packard, Mercedes-Benz, and the whole run of them, even Rolls-Royce. The company was purchased by the General Motors subsidiary Fisher Body in 1925. They promised that they would not move the works for at least 5 years, and they were as good as their word. In 1930, exactly 5 years later, General Motors moved the fabrication operations to Detroit. The Fleetwood name was used by Cadillac for its luxury line for another 60 years. I was asked to speak at the dedication and also at a little gathering that they had as part of a luncheon. And I tried to give them information that does not appear online. There's a great deal online on the Fleetwood Metal Body Company. A good friend of ours, Lillian Schlegel Walters, her father was the treasurer of the company when it first was organized. And she recalled a number of things that at a visit to her house one night. I'm going to skip a little bit of this in the interest of time to comment on something that she told me that no one seemed to know, which surprised me, considering all that's been written about the Fleetwood Auto Body. One of the unusual features of the company's business practice was the seasonal switching of automobile bodies. Some owners were in possession of both a closed body for the winter and an open body for the summer. At some point in the fall, the summer body was sent to the factory for its removal from the chassis and replaced by the winter body. The winter body was stored at the plant until the following spring. During its stay at Fleetwood, any dents or dings would be removed and the body would otherwise be made like new. Lillian recalled seeing the stored bodies. An aluminum body, of course, was more vulnerable to denting than a steel body. When you think about it, by changing the bodies twice a year, when they got them back, they were essentially driving a new car every time that switch was made, because they would never give them a car that wasn't completely restored. It's interesting to note that prior to General Motors' acquisition of the company in 1925, many more custom bodies were made for a Packard chassis than for Cadillacs. Articles on the internet make mention of the famous movie stars, European royalty, the presidents that owned cars sporting Fleetwood bodies. Among these was the world-famous operatic tenor, who died in 1921, the legendary Enrico Caruso, whose recordings for the company Victor Talking Machine are legendary, and also made the Victor Talking Machine Company. One second. A photo in a Victor catalog gives a glimpse of his new car, the body of which was made locally. Not incidentally, Caruso's grandson is a resident of Wyomissing. The great tenor died August the 21st, 1921. As many are aware, when General Motors moved its bodybuilding operation from Fleetwood, few, if any, of the locals left town. They were offered jobs in Detroit. Few left. Accordingly, some of the world's finest craftsmen remained living in Fleetwood. Among these were George Stump of Main Street, who was the head canvas top maker for the touring cars and other open models. In 1960, he crafted a top for my 1930 Ford Cabriolet that was sheer perfection. Regrettably, after 20 years of wear, it had to be replaced with less satisfactory results. Among the other fellows who stayed locally was Mr. Stitzer, who was the principal pinstriper. He was held in high regard for his mastery of that art form. Next. At the little luncheon, they had a cake. Mm-hmm. And you can see the cake that they produced, an SGV body, an SGV, excuse me, chassis with a Fleetwood body. That was its part of the cake. Next. Gertrude Sternberg. Her dad was the S, the Sternberg in SGV. And Gertrude is behind the wheel of her car. And her sister, the Portis, sits behind her. Who the person is behind her, I don't know. But that's what amazes me. Do you remember this? About the trip that they took to Europe. And was it Lambert who drove? He was very young at the time. He drove one of those monstrous cars. I guess they took it by ship and docked it. And they drove through something, was it like eight countries? All through Europe. It amazes me that they didn't have a breakdown. I can just wonder how many tires they went through. I can only imagine. My grandfather said when they went to Atlantic City, he always had six tires with him. So at this time period, I can only imagine. But... and I wonder whatever happened, because they had two SGVs. I'd love to know whatever happened to those things. I guess we'll never know that. Okay, the next. Okay. let's hold that for a second. Anything that you want to report for Center Park?
Sure. Can we go to the graphic that we have for Center Park? We have our... December events coming up here. If we have a graphic, I can rattle them off. Anyway, so in December, we have, there we go. first up, on Saturday, December the 2nd, at 4:30 in Center Park, the park itself, which is located in the 700 block of Center Avenue, we have our official tree lighting, and we actually just finished decorating that tree yesterday. it's free, free hot chocolate and popcorn, and Santa Claus comes and does the official tree lighting. So that's Saturday, December the 2nd from 4:30 until 6. Come out and join us for that. Sunday, December the 9th is our Moonlight VIP house tour. And for $50 advance purchase only, this VIP tour is limited to 60 people. And what it is, basically you get to do the Center Park Christmas house tour the night before everyone else. And then at the conclusion of that private tour, you get to go to a very nice residence in Center Park for a VIP cocktail party with food provided by Sterling Guest Hotel. I am one of the tour guides again this year, and if you're interested, I would buy your tickets now because it's limited to 60 people, and this tour has sold out for the, looks this is our third year we're doing it. So it does sell out pretty quickly, and it is a very, very nice event, so I highly recommend it. The next day, Sunday, December the 10th, there we go, is Center Park's 33rd annual Christmas house tour. Basically, you can buy your ticket in advance by calling Center Park or visiting our website, centerparkhistoricdistrict.org. Tickets are $18 in advance or $20 the day of the tour. You would come to Center Park the day of the tour, and we have a tent there where you can buy your ticket there. And you'll get a tour booklet with a map and all of the properties on there, and it's a self-guided tour, as well as some other locations that will be on the tour and open. The Inn at Center Park is also doing a brunch this year. Brunch only is $35, and for some reason we do not have the ticket price and the brunch price together on this. But for a...
Yes, it's 48.
Is it there? Oh, there it is, the combo ticket. I'm not even seeing it. $48, thank you, is the combo ticket for the Christmas tour and the brunch. Highly recommended. It's a very popular event. Again, this is our 33rd year of doing this tour. It's quite popular. And you'll get to see our beautiful neighborhood. And we also have a shuttle that goes from First Energy Baseball Stadium, so you can park there and take the shuttle into Center Park, do the tour, and then be shuttled back to First Energy Stadium for parking, back to your car. Advance ticket sales end December the 8th, so come out and join us. It should be a nice event.
They have a website, don't they?
We have a website again. It's centerparkhistoricdistrict.org. And if you like us on Facebook, we also promote all of our events on there as well.
Very good. So that's it basically for Center Park.
I don't want to go too far ahead. We obviously have many events coming in 2018, but those are the most important events coming up for December. This is our 35th anniversary. 2017 is the 35th anniversary of Center Park Historic District.
Very good. Right. Okay, thank you, Tadd.
Thank
Shall we move on?
All right. Last month, we provided viewers of this series an overview of Alsace Township's Historical Views calendar for 2018. And today we present another such publication, Amity Township's 2018 Historical Calendar, produced by the Amity Heritage Society, headquartered at the 19th century Fairview Chapel along the Philadelphia Pike in Exeter Township, near headquarters of Service Electric TV Cable Company.
Yes. All right, we have the next graphic. Very good.
There we are.
That's the cover. This was a creamery that lay along the Weavertown Road at the entrance to. Is the public school vacated there on Weavertown Road on top of the hill? Are they using that at all, or is that empty?
The old Amity Elementary?
Yes.
That is now empty. That is where I went to elementary school, and my grandfather went to school there, and my great-grandmother was a teacher there.
And they abandoned it even though you went? Well, anyhow.
Yes. They should have a historical marker there.
I would certainly think so. Anyhow, that creamery was built by J. Harry Scher in the 1890s. This, of course, was the Amityville Creamery, even though I guess it was at Weavertown, but who's going to mince words? It was located at the section, at the intersection of Weavertown Road and Route 662. I am told that with that school, when you go up that driveway to the building on top of the hill, at the foot of that driveway was exactly where that creamery sat. So, of course, nothing whatever is that, left there. It was purchased by the Burdens Creamery Company in 1918. It was removed to make way for the new Amity Consolidated School Building, built in 1931. Next. It's a very interesting picture. I'm not sure whether they went to a maying, but there we had those lovely maidens with the rakes in their hands. It's listed as an Amity Heritage Society favorite. Not a whole lot of information on that, but the picture itself tells the story. Next.
Yeah, there we go.
I like this one. A lot of these stations, by the way, were designed by the famous Frank Furness. Mm-hmm. Many times people will call him Frank Furness. When I spoke with his son many, many years ago, I said, Mr. Furness, he said, the name is Furness, like the stove in your cellar. So I stood corrected. Anyhow, this beautiful Victorian station in Douglasville was taken down in the 1970s. Shown in the background is the Douglasville Hotel, which still operates. Needless to say, there's nothing whatever left of that very handsome station. You can always tell the Frank Furness buildings, but yeah, by the bulbous chimneys and the woodwork that people hated to paint. Next. That's a very interesting picture. I wasn't aware of this until I started doing a little restoration work on it. built in 1877 by the Monocacy Bridge Company. You know, Monocacy had a furnace. Not too well known, but they did. This iron trestle bridge spans the Schuylkill River at Monocacy. It was supplanted by the current concrete bridge in the 1940s. That's an unusual structure. Next. the Monocacy Hotel in the 1930s, that building still stands. The porch, I think, has been removed. And notice there's a train in the background, and there's a fellow out there. Can you see him?
Yeah.
Okay, it's a fellow out there, I guess, with a flag or something. It was a Keystone store. The Keystone store was one of those outfits where local grocers sort of banded together to get things at a better price, and one of the companies that accommodated a certain group of grocers was the Keystone Store Company. The Monocacy Hotel and General Store. That's an interesting picture. Notice the title gas pump on at the front porch below the Keystone Store Company sign. In the background, you can see a watchman guarding the crossing of a freight train of coal as it passes by. I oftentimes think, can you imagine how many watchmen they employed years ago at a time where they had a man at every crossing? Just in the city of Reading, it was amazing how many men found employment. The older people in the audience probably remember the watchman at 7th and Penn with his little building next to Reed's department store, how he would come out and all the old men would sit alongside of his little building there, bending his ear. But that was a place of congregation on Penn Street years ago, the Watchman's Box. Overlooking the mill race, this view is of the colonial grist mill built by John Schrack in the early 1800s. That's the center picture that you see. Known today as Flannery's Mill, it was severely damaged by Hurricane Agnes in 1972. There wasn't a lot of it left until Agnes came in. There was great damage in that general area, and what little was left was more or less washed away. We watched them. Maybe you remember that. They brought some Amishmen in to salvage as much as they could in 72. The Flannery family was the last to own and operate the mill. The Flannery's had it for a long time. Next. Uh, yeah, loading the milk. Loading the milk cans at Douglasville Train Depot in the 1900s. It's nice to pin down a date on these pictures. Next. You know, there must have been a government contract, because I have any number of pictures of rural delivery men, the mailmen, and all their vehicles look exactly the same. Mm-hmm. So they must have built them according to a supplied pattern. Amity Township mailman Charles G. Rhodes is standing by his mail delivery wagon and horse, Barney. This I like a lot. Imagine what that would be worth today. Look at the light on it. Which that's a brass. Anyhow, longtime Monocacy Station resident Virginia Klein poses in her fancy pedal car. Her riding apparel came complete with hat, goggles, and leather driving gloves. Note the kerosene headlamp mounted on the front. That was a handsome little thing. It probably wound up in the scrap drive of the 1940s. Proudly displaying the new Monarch Fire Company's truck is John A. Flannery, Jr. Purchased in 1943, this truck was built by the Horn Motor Company. Organized in 1935, the Monarch Fire Company was first housed in Flannery's mill. There's a picture in one of the passing scene books of a fire apparatus in the back part of the mill. Next. Formerly known as the Broadview Garage, this building is currently a residence. It's very obvious as you drive down 422, the building it would lie on the north side of 422 as you're progressing to Douglasville. It's located along present day 422 in Amity Township. Do not look for the pumps. A lot has been changed at that site. By the way, you see these old photographs with all the pumps outside? Those were a variety of gas stations. The last two that survived was one near the Sinking Spring Drive-In Theater. Today there's a Speed Shop in that particular building. Another one was where the Burger King is along 422 at Gibraltar Road and the Philadelphia Pike. That variety gas station was the last one to really offer a choice of gasolines. Rudy Dexter was the proprietor. There was a time when there was a decided difference in gasolines, and that's why you had a choice of what it was that you put into your car. I remember I drove Texaco for a long time and used Kendall Motor Oil 40-weight. Next. The hit-and-miss engine was utilized by many local farmers for various tasks. Here, the Levin Good Boys are using it to power a bucksaw to cut firewood. This is one of the neatest pictures. That and the other bridge fascinate me. Notice the boys in the water itself. Mm-hmm. There were a number of those bridges. Of course, all of them fell victim. I remember the swinging bridge that used to be at Spangsville. It was a suspension bridge made of wood, which they providentially tore down during the bicentennial in 1976, on the very day that I was giving a lecture at the Historical Society on Historic Ole. They chose that day to tear it down. But anyhow, crossing the Manitowoc Creek, this old footbridge was located just downstream from present-day Manitowoc Creek Winery. And the last picture for December of 2018, the aerial view shows Sunrise Hills as it looked in the late 1950s. These houses were built adjacent to the Amity Gardens development. The street shown is Merritt Avenue, where it intersects with Nicholson Avenue. Now,
during the past week, a demolition crew was busy removing the landmark caretaker's residence that stood high above Lake Antietam, and an illustrated article appeared in today's Reading Eagle.
Maybe we'll go through that fast, and then we'll... Oh. More about that next month. Dr. Grafe Arthur D. Grafe was honored at Conrad Weiser High School. He was a graduate of the class of 1917, and he's was put on the list of distinguished. There we are. We'll go through this fast. This was in the paper today about the caretaker's house being demolished. By the way, these photographs were supplied by our good friend Kerry Moon, who lives in Sinking Spring. He's a historian and a postcard collector. Demolition occurred within the last week. All that remains of the caretaker's house is its stone foundation. That's a very good and very early picture, by the way. It hasn't looked like that for a long, long time. I don't recall it ever looking exactly what you're seeing there. The site itself stands above the dam breast. The county bought Antietam Lake from the city of Reading in 28 with plans to develop properly the 643-acre park. That was a very interesting story when it was purchased from the city of Reading. I was one-fifth owner of Lake Antietam for 3 days, I believe. The lake itself dates from 1865 when Reading purchased the Antietam Creek area in Lower Alsace and created a lake to impound water for the wants of the city, principally drinking water. They reached a point in the city of Reading where the water wasn't all that great because of the great number of cemeteries that were sprinkled throughout the city of Reading, particularly in the 6th Street area. And while you dearly loved Aunt Maud, you didn't want to drink her essence. So that pushed forward the need for city-provided water. Water was transported to Reading by gravity. In 1880, the octagonal brick valve house was constructed on a stone foundation. Its purpose was to control the flow of water. The caretaker's house was added so there would be someone at the site to control the valves and to generally watch over things. It is said he rode a horse and buggy every day to inspect the Bingaman and Antietam Creek tributaries to check runoff from farms in the area. The dam, next picture please. The dam was enlarged and reconstructed several times before the city switched to its water supply being provided from Lake Oneolone. Isn't that a neat picture? Mm-hmm. The valve house. You can no longer go out there to do what those ladies are doing. Next. And that is another old picture of the valve house. Okay, we have more, but I'm going to defer to the gentlemen who are kind enough to be with us this evening to talk about the Reading Chamber.
At this time, we're pleased to present our two guests, Dr. Thomas B. Souders and Dr. John R. Pankratz, who appear on behalf of the Friends of Chamber Music, a group that this year is observing its 65th anniversary. Customarily, their concerts are given at 140 North 5th Street at the Women's Club of Reading, a building which early in the last century was home to the Wyomissing Club. Gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Thank you for allowing us to talk about our organization. We appreciate that very much.
We're pleased to have you.
It's a musical presentation organization, and so I brought a little music along, and I wondered whether or not we might begin with a small bit of Biedrich Smetana.
We will.
Biedrich Smetana was a Czech composer, contemporary of Dvořák, who wrote a wonderful string quartet. We'll hear a little bit of the fourth movement of it. The quartet is called From My Life, and it's autobiographical.
Bear with us here as we
fire it up
here and hopefully get it to play. We are playing volume. I'm not sure about volume.
Perhaps we could have more volume. Well, while they're firing that up, maybe
it's ironic that's because fine. The acoustics at the Women's Club of Reading
yes.
are absolutely
they're
fabulous.
Wonderful. They're yeah. wonderful. They really are.
But I was hopeful that we might be able to hear that because it's a recording that was done by the Curtis String Quartet, and the Curtis Quartet was very important in the early years of the formation of our organization. Before I talk about the Curtis, though, which gave us concerts for 25 years, I want to talk a little bit about what chamber music is. There is a wide spectrum of classical music, and chamber music deals with the smaller forms. These forms of anywhere from 2 to 10 groups of musicians. But at the heart of chamber music is the string quartet, and those smaller forms which deal with the piano. It seems as if the piano has a wonderful synchrony with stringed instruments, particularly the violin. And so the piano trio is very important for us, too. There are huge numbers of works written for a string quartet and for piano trio.
Recognize Kavinsky anywhere. Where was that recording?
Where? Mm-hmm. I think it was a Philadelphia recording studio. Yeah. You could hear the excitement in the work. It's a very lively piece of music which ends abruptly with a very high E, mm-hmm. Which demonstrates that Smetana was going deaf, and this is the first tone that he heard. That's why it's autobiographical. But it's also significant in that the Curtis String Quartet made a very few recordings. They were among the great American quartets of the early to middle part of the 20th century. So we're dealing with the quartet, string quartet, the piano trio, and those forms which build around it, from anywhere from 2 players to 10 players. And we now have 8 concerts a year. We started with 2 concerts a year. And I want to talk a little bit about the genesis of the beginnings of the Friends of Chamber Music. My father started it. He was an ophthalmologist, born in 1912. His mother convinced him that a violin would be a nice thing to try. And so he began studying violin. He fell in love with the instrument, with the sound of it, and with Jascha Heifetz's recordings, which were then coming out. And he then developed that further through medical school, and he went to the University of Pennsylvania, where he studied ophthalmology. This is important because his professor at Penn was a fine violinist himself. He owned a Stradivarius, and he had many friends in the musical world of Philadelphia, which was among the greatest in the world at that time. Philadelphia was a very musical city in the 20th century and 19th as well. And this man's name was Dr. Frank Adler. He introduced my father, while he was in training, to the members of the Curtis String Quartet. Curtis String Quartet was a legendary quartet by that time, which was around 1940. 3 of them had come out of the first graduating class of the Curtis Institute, along with Giancarlo Menotti and Samuel Barber. They decided to form a quartet. Orlando Cole, the great cellist, Max Aronoff, the violist, and then a year or two later, Yasha Brodsky, a great virtuoso out of Russia. They then became some of the great teachers at the Curtis Institute. They also formed their own music school, the New School of Music. They talked to my father. He went away as an ophthalmologist to the war, came back to Reading. And in the very early 1950s, he received a call from Max Aronoff, the violist, asking whether the Curtis Quartet might come to Reading to do a concert. So my father thought about it a little bit. I talked to Earl Poole at the museum, and they found a room in the second floor of the museum, which would, they thought, be ideal for chamber music. It's with the great Christopher Shearer painting in the background. That was the first concert in April of 1953. There were about 50 to 75 people there. The quartet was such a success that my father decided he'd try another one. But from the very beginning, his thought was that these should be free concerts. And the Curtis Quartet encouraged that by stating, well, if you can have enough patron contributions, we'll just use it for our scholarship fund at the New School of Music. And that's what they did. And ever since then, these concerts have been free and open to the community. They're not really free because we need a certain critical mass of people to give us money in order to sustain the series of 8 concerts that we give every year. But we're happy that we've been able to do this for so long. For the first 25 years, the Curtis Quartet gave us all of our concerts, beginning 2 concerts a year, slowly increasing to 3. But then after that, with the death of Max Aronoff, the quartet disbanded. They had been present as a string quartet for 55 years up till that time. And then the DePasquale Quartet was there waiting for us. The DePasquale is a wonderful family, first chair people in the Philadelphia Orchestra who had many friends in the musical circles, and they brought their friends to Reading. So we developed further the Friends of Chamber Music series with the DePasquales as the center. But we also started to expand to 3 and 4 and 5 concerts a year. And Orlando Cole by then, the cellist, had many great students at Curtis, and he recommended to us ensembles where his students were cellists. So we expanded the series by bringing those ensembles in, and we found a lot of youthful and very exciting young ensembles through that. So the DePasquale Quartet gave us 25 more years of concerts, even while we were expanding the series with other kinds of musical groups. We gradually grew in numbers and in financial support. We outgrew the museum very soon. I had gone away to study, and I came back in 1969. By that time, my father had moved the concerts to the Women's Club of Reading, which had a particularly wonderful acoustic, which is one of our great strengths as a musical organization. In 1971, my father died, and so I took over the series. About 10 years later, I had the good fortune of meeting Dr. Neil Hoffman, a pathologist at the Reading Hospital who was a clarinetist of really professional stature. And he and I formed a bond through music. He joined me and we incorporated. It became a nonprofit. And from then we grew. We grew a board, which now has 11 people. And 3 years ago, we had the great fortune also of finding a wonderful executive director in Sherry Gleason Meyerhofer. She's a professional horn player and pianist who teaches at Kutztown. So she is our executive director, and we very much appreciate what she is able to do for us. Since the 1970s, we've had a lot of success and support from the Reading Musical Foundation, which has been very important to us. Looking back on these, I've been involved almost a half a century. I can't believe that, George, but
I can.
But we have given 282 concerts free to the community, and we're very proud of that. Mm-hmm. We have also allowed 150 or more chamber musicians to play for us. They need work, and they love to play for us because our audience is very knowledgeable. The acoustics are wonderful. They sound great in the hall, and they like the fact that the audience responds back to them. So they want to keep coming back. So we have too many groups. We have to bring some back every other year. But that's what has happened in the history of the organization, and I'd like to ask John to talk about the present.
Well, I have to say that it's a complete privilege for me to join this great family tradition that has now become a community tradition. I've been in Reading now for almost 30 years, and I have to admit that I came late to the Friends of Chamber Music, even though I grew up with chamber music back in Toledo, Ohio. But I have come to regard this series as really the crown jewel in Reading's cultural scene. It's a chance for people in the community of all backgrounds to encounter really some of the most remarkable, most searching musical creations ever created, performed by some of the most esteemed ensembles in the world. And so it's music of an incredibly high quality that we've managed to make accessible. And I think that model, that heritage from the Curtis Quartet, the idea of being able to present these free of charge to the public without tickets, it's a very welcoming entry into this world of marvelous music making. We're certainly grateful to our patrons and donors each year. They make it possible, but we love having that door open and welcoming young people and old people and everyone in between. I teach at Albright, of course, and almost every concert I try to bring in a couple students who may be musicians themselves or may be new to chamber music, and give them the opportunity to discover this great musical heritage. I think it's particularly nice that we're here on the show talking about the old, and this is a scene from the past that hasn't passed. It's still very much alive, still very vibrant. Music going back to the 18th century, but music also being composed in the 21st century and performed in the most vivid and honest way possible.
What is coming up for the rest of the season?
Well, we've got a whole group of people. We might have our brochure cover there. We'd be happy to send people a copy of that. We began with the Alethea Trio, a member of the De Pasquale family and two of her associates, and gave a wonderful concert in October. Just this past weekend, students and faculty members from the Bard Conservatory performed for us, including the Beethoven Septet, which is a wonderful work to hear. In January, a trio, flute, cello, and piano, Dulce Suono, will be performing. Then in, I can't quite see the dates, the Daedalus Quartet, one of the quartets with whom we have an ongoing relationship. They come back every other year, perhaps every third year as well. They're the quartet in residence at Columbia University, and I think also at Penn. Mm-hmm. A new group on our series, the Cooperstown Quartet, includes one of our great friends, Michael Cannon, cellist, a new quartet that he's formed in the last couple years, and they'll include our series as part of their initial national tour. Then a group, the Tempest Trio, I think we even have a picture of the Tempest Trio back there, very distinguished, sort of an all-star piano quartet. Ilya Kaler, Amit Peled, and Alon Goldstein playing just remarkable music. The Aeolus Quartet is one of our annual treats. Rachel Shapiro is the second violinist, and she's a native of Reading and a graduate of Wyomissing High School. And her associates come back every year to perform for us. They've been the graduate quartet at Juilliard and have really made a name for themselves. So many of these musicians are young people and keeping this great cultural heritage alive. And then, as has been our tradition for, I think, 14 or 15 years, the Brentano Quartet, a very, very distinguished ensemble, the quartet in residence at Yale, will give our May concert, and it's just really a vibrant season, and I think almost every concert deserves and receives a standing ovation from the audience, and I know the musicians appreciate that, and it's a thrill to be there. So this is really an open invitation
to you to celebrate some of Albright's or some of Reading's cultural heritage with the Friends of Chamber Music. So we hope to see you at the Women's Club of Reading in our upcoming concerts.
There's a website that they can they can check for the dates.
That's
what
right.
What is that website?
It's called chambermusicreading.org.
Chambermusicreading.org.
Mm-hmm. And
I miss the Los Angeles Piano Quartet.
We do too. They
they
have disbanded.
Yes,
they were wonderful.
Oh, it's a wonderful group.
The problem with some, we become enamored of these groups. They become great friends of ours. They want to come back because mm-hmm. they're treated so well here. And yet, something happens, they disband. So we try to find another group to take their place. We have found a good piano quartet in Philadelphia, and we hope that that may be part of our season next year or the year after.
Mm-hmm. We had a piano quartet that appeared in one of the Hague concerts years ago. Is it the first piano quartet?
Yes, as a famous group.
They made Columbia Records, as I recall. Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was at that concert. But we had a chamber group in Reading years back, and I'm just trying to think. It's been so long since I thought about that. Willy Richter played the piano, Hans Nix mm-hmm. violin, and was there a Hangen on the cello, Mr. Hangen, of Hangen's Music Store? That goes back a long time. Mm-hmm. But I remember them.
I think the musical heritage of Reading really helps to support this series as well. The fact, as Tom says, there's such a knowledgeable audience, such an appreciative audience, I think also lures these groups back.
And part of that can be attributed to Dr. Haig with these Haig concerts all those years. He brought some of the incredible people to the city of Reading. I remember the day that I was the day that he brought Beverly Sills, I could not believe. Mm-hmm. She was on the front cover of Time magazine one week and singing in Reading the next. Mm-hmm. That blew me away. Mm-hmm.
He brought Piatarevsky here, the great, and Richard Strauss right after the Second World War, just before he died.
I started in 46 going to those things. So I saw everyone practically from 46 until that very last one with the pianist that was so poorly attended, unfortunately. We got that last one in the Hague concerts. Gertrude's friend.
Andre Watts?
No.
John Browning.
Yes.
Mm. John Browning.
That was the last mm-hmm. of the Hague concerts. Gloria and I walked out and I said, Gloria, there were 75 people in the house? Mm-hmm. I said, this has to be the end. It's so unfortunate. Mm-hmm. But for many, many years, he brought some of the greatest people. When he brought Galacorchi, that time they were giving them at the Strand Theater. It was a complete sellout. Nelson Eddy, they were standing on the stage when he came for his one of his things. Gloria Jean, do you want to...
On behalf of our program host, Georgia Meiser IX, Tadd Kelby Casner, and guest Dr. Thomas Souders and Professor John Pankratz, we thank you for watching. I'm Gloria Jean Meiser, the program's announcer. A high-quality rerun of this show and many of our previous shows may be viewed on BCTV's website by typing in the passing scene in the box at the upper right-hand corner of the screen. Our programs also can be viewed on YouTube by typing in The Passing Scene. Watch for our next show on the third Monday in December 2017.
We thank you.
The Passing Scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.